गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन, माई सेल्फ कौसर मोमिन, नाइन्थ स्टैंडर्ड, सब्जेक्ट साइंस, चैप्टर नंबर वन, लॉज ऑफ मोशन. इन दिस चैप्टर वी स्टडीड अप टू सॉल्व एग्जाम्पल्स. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विथ न्यूटन्स लॉ ऑफ मोशन. बिफोर टू स्टार्ट दिस टॉपिक वी विल understand few examples, then we can clear our topic. Okay, so very first example is a static object does not move without the application of a force. Obviously any static object you have to apply a force for the moment, right? The force which is sufficient to lift a book from a table is not sufficient to lift the table. Obviously for a book to lift we need a small amount of force, but for lifting of table we need a larger amount of force. So both forces are not equal. Number three, fruits on a tree fall down when its branches are shaken. For the shaking of branch of tree we need a force, then only fruits get fall down. Okay, an electric fence keeps on rotating for some time even after it is switched off. Do you have any idea about after getting switched off why the fan is moving? So obviously a few charge store in it and the fan is having accessibility of the moment, like moment is there in the fan. So it continues after some time. So that is, that comes also a force. It comes in a part of inertia, movement. So all these things comes with the Newton's law of motion. Okay, so if we look for reason of the above, we realize that object have some inertia. We have learned the inertia is related to the mass of the object. If any object has a mass, then that has inertia. Newton's first law of motion describes this very property and is therefore called law of inertia. All instances of inertia are examples of Newton's first law of motion. To understand in detail, we'll go ahead with the example of balance and unbalanced force. You must have played tug of war so long as the forces applied by the both the sides are equal, that is balanced. The center of the rope is static in spite of the applied forces. On the other hand, when the applied forces become unequal, that is unbalanced, a net force gets applied in the direction of greater force and the center of the rope shifts in that direction. When an object is at rest or in uniform motion along a straight line, it does not mean that no force is acting on it. Actually, there are number of forces acting on it, but they cancel one another, so that net force is zero. Newton's first law explains the phenomenon of inertia. Newton's first law explains the phenomenon of inertia. And inertia has three types: inertia of rest, inertia of direction, and inertia of motion. That is, the ability of an object to change its state of motion on its own. It also explains the unbalanced forces which cause a change in the state of an object at rest or in uniform motion. So here we can say that a body continues to be in its state of rest or of uniform motion unless acted upon by an unbalanced external force. So here you can observe that you can clearly see it. An object continues to remain at rest or in a state of uniform motion along a straight line unless an external unbalanced force acts on it. So this comes in your Newton's first law of motion. नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज न्यूटन्स सेकेंड लॉ ऑफ मोशन. टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस टॉपिक आई विल गिव यू टू एग्जाम्पल. सपोज टेक टू ऑब्जेक्ट स्मॉलर एज वेल एज बिगर ए एंड बी. हिट दिस ऑब्जेक्ट ऑन बी. सो इज दिस बी ऑब्जेक्ट विल शिफ्ट फ्रॉम दिस पोजिशन टू अनदर? ऑब्वियसली नो. दिस ऑब्जेक्ट इज वेरी स्मॉलर दैन दिस वन. सो दैट मच फोर्स इज नॉट अप्लाइड बाय दिस ए ऑब्जेक्ट ऑन बी. बट इंस्टेड ऑफ दैट वी आर टेकिंग अनदर कंडीशन. इफ यू हैव ए ऑब्जेक्ट एज bigger and b object as smaller. Now hit this bigger object on smaller one. Then this smaller object will change its place to other. It will change its place to other side. It will move from one place to another. So what is happening over here? So if your object is heavier, then it has maximum mass. We can say it as mass. It has maximum mass as compared to the smaller object. Same thing we are applying for our definition. You can observe here the effect of one object striking another object depends both on mass of the former and its velocity. This means that effect of the force depends on a property related to both mass and velocity of the striking object. So whatever effect is happening over here, it is depend upon mass and velocity of that object. Velocity is nothing but distance upon time. And obviously we striking it out means it is changing its distance with respect to time. So velocity is there and it is depend upon mass as well as. So this property termed as momentum. And it is described by Newton. Okay, now what is momentum? Momentum has magnitude as well as direction. Its direction is same as that of velocity. In SI system, unit of momentum is kilogram meter per second, while CGS system is gram centimeter per second. If an unbalanced force applied on an object causes a change of velocity of the object, then it also causes change in its momentum. The force necessary to cause a change in momentum of the object depends upon the rate of change of momentum. Let me give you example why object velocity changes are there, right? So this is the example. Ask your friend drop one plastic and one rubber ball from the same height. Obviously, which will fall down earlier? The rubber ball, because rubber ball has mass much more as compared to the plastic ball. So it will fall down earlier as compared to plastic ball. So this here you can consider the rubber ball has mass maximum as compared to plastic ball. And what about velocity? It drops earlier as compared to the plastic ball. So velocity also differs for plastic ball. Distance is this height of the distance is same, but time match manner like time differ is there. Suppose for rubber ball, minute a second, 1 second needs for rubber ball, but for plastic ball, 1 minute needs over there. So due to this time differing, velocity changes, and velocity mass is going to change. That is why its momentum also change. Think for this two example in the similar manner, and consider this momentum with this example. Think yourself. Still, if you have doubt with this example, ask me. So hence we can say that momentum is nothing but is the product of mass and velocity of an object. For momentum we are using P letter. Capital P is the letter for momentum. So P is equals to M into V. M is what? Mass. V is what? Velocity. So mass, velocity. Velocity is a which quantity? Scalar or vector? It is a vector quantity. So we can say that momentum is a vector quantity. Okay. So the rate of change of momentum is proportional to the applied force, and that of change of momentum occurs in the direction of the force. द रेट ऑफ चेंज ऑफ मोमेंटम मीन्स वट एवर मोमेंटम इज गोइंग ऑन फॉर दैट देर इज नीड ऑफ टाइम दैट इज रेट ऑफ चेंज ऑफ मोमेंटम द रेशियो ऑफ चेंज इन मोमेंटम अपॉन टाइम नाउ हाउ चेंज इन मोमेंटम इज देयर सपोज आई हैव अ बॉल फॉर दैट बॉल अ स्पेसिफिक मास इज देयर सपोज दिस वन इज बॉल दिस इज एट ए आई हैव टू पोजिशन ए पोजिशन एंड बी पोजिशन एंड दिस बॉल हैज़ अ स्पेसिफिक मास ओके वट अबाउट इज इनिशियल वेलोसिटी इट इज़ एट रेस्ट पोजिशन दैट इज़ वाई इनिशियल वेलोसिटी इज यू सो दिस कम्स विथ मोमेंटम ओके नाउ इट इज चेंजिंग इट्स डिसप्लेसमेंट इट मूव्स फ्रॉम पोजिशन ए टू पोजिशन बी Now, when it is moving from position A to position B, is any difference between its mass? No, obviously the same ball is coming at this side, so mass is same. Now, what about its velocity? Now, the velocity is become some velocity it occurs, so that is why we can see it as final velocity. This is also a momentum. So, the momentum, there is a difference between this momentum, change in momentum, we can say that. There is a difference between this momentum and we can see it as change in momentum. And this, for the change in momentum, we can use this to this, okay? M into V to M into U. So, for that, here is the thing for change in momentum. You can see over here, rate of change of momentum. mv minus mu this gives us change in momentum how change in momentum comes I have shown you with the example of ball okay and this t is the time now m I am taking common and v minus u upon t is nothing but acceleration acceleration is nothing but change in velocity and change in velocity means my final velocity minus initial velocity upon time so this is nothing but acceleration so that is why we can substitute this thing here so we are getting m into a is nothing but v minus u upon t a is acceleration acceleration is nothing but change in velocity upon t so this is my formula rate of change of momentum comes mass into acceleration so according to the Newton's second law of motion the rate of change of momentum is proportional to the applied force So, I can write this is my rate of change of momentum. This rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to applied force. This is Newton's second law of motion. So, whatever the statement is there, I am writing in this form. Rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to force. Now, if variation is there, definitely we are taking constant of proportionality we are keeping over there so instead of that I am keeping constant of proportionality and I'm getting equals sign so it is f is equals to k into ma constant of proportionality we can keep a value 1 so here we are getting f is equals to ma f is force is applied force mass and acceleration so f is equals to m into a Consider two objects having different masses which are initially at rest. I am having two objects which are having different masses. Okay. So obviously size differs. The initial momentum for both is zero. The initial momentum for both is zero means P is zero. Suppose a force F acts for time t on both the objects so I am applying a force for both object the lighter objects start moving faster than the heavier and the lighter objects start moving faster than the heavier however from the above formula we know that rate of change of momentum that is f in both object is same and the total change in their momentum will also be same that is f T. Thus, if the same force is applied on the different object, the change in momentum will be same. If your size of object is different, then also their change in momentum will be same because FT, time matters over there, for you are applying a same force, so whatever moment change of momentum is there, that will be same if your size of object will be different. Okay? Now next topic is Newton's third law of motion. However, in nature, force cannot be alone. Definitely, force cannot be act alone. Force is reciprocal action between two objects. Forces are always applied in pairs. When one object applies a force on another object, the latter object also simultaneously applies a force on the former object. I'll give you a very nice example for the same. If you hit on the wall, definitely you'll also get hurt on your hand, right? If you are hitting on the wall, then definitely you also will get a harm on your hand. So definitely whatever force you are up on the wall, that much force comes on your hand also. Okay, so this is idea expressed Newton's third law of motion. The force applied by the first object is called action force, while the force applied by the second object on the first is called reaction force. So the statement for Newton's third law of motion is every action force has an equal and opposite reaction force, which acts simultaneously. Every action force has an equal and opposite reaction force which acts simultaneously. Very basic example, hit with your hand on wall, definitely whatever force you are applying on the wall, that much force comes on your hand and you'll get hurt. Don't do this activity, don't apply like much more pressure, but to understand this topic, just do it little way. Okay, so Newton's third law of motion is every action force has an equal and opposite reaction force which acts simultaneously. So now next topic is law of conservation of momentum. Suppose an object A has mass m1 and its initial velocity is u1. An object B has mass m2 and initial velocity u2. How it comes? In the previous also I gave you two examples with respect to a ball. Object means here we are considering two balls we are having. Okay, suppose A and B balls are there. They are having rest position, and because of they are having rest position, their momentum will be, this will be mass as m1 and initial velocity u1. For this, mass as m2 and initial velocity is u2. Because of they are in rest position, that is why here we are taking their initial velocity. And definitely they are having different masses. So according to the formula of momentum, we can write initial momentum for A is m1 u1 and that of B is m2 u2. Suppose these two objects collide with each other. Suppose these two objects gets collide with each other. Okay. So we can say that the force A due to B will be F1. And this force will cause acceleration in A. If these two balls gets collide with each other, then ball A due to B, then the force acts on A will be F1 and its velocity will become V1. So momentum of A after collision will be M1 and V1. Why V1 is there? Because obviously this ball is A and it has a momentum after getting collision. Since it takes and velocity with that, and it will be m1 and v1. So according to Newton's third law of motion, A also exerts an equal force on B, but in the opposite direction. This will cause a change in momentum of B if its velocity after collision is v2. So we can say that the momentum of B after collision is m2 v2. If f2 is the force that act on object B, so definitely both the forces are equal, but they are having opposite direction. After colliding these two balls with each other, they are having equal force, but direction is opposite. So we can write, if the direction is opposite, then both are equal. F2 is equal to F1, but the direction is opposite. So that is why we are taking a minus sign with it. Okay. Therefore, instead of F2, I am writing M2, A2. Why I am writing? Because F is equals to MA, which we have seen in second law, right? So, because of F2, M2, A2 is there. Because of F1, M1, A1 is there. And this is minus sign because they collide. After colliding, they get opposite direction. But both force are equal. Okay. Now, instead of A2, I am substituting a value. Acceleration is nothing but V minus U upon 2. So this acceleration I am substituting over here. For if it is A2, so I am writing V2 minus U2 upon T. If it is A1, instead of this I am writing V1 minus U1 upon T. So both T get cancelled in denominator. And afterwards I am getting this M2 into V2 minus U2 is equals to minus of M1 in the bracket V1 minus U1. So open the bracket. After multiplying this, M2 V2 minus M2 U2 is equals to M1 V1 plus, because minus minus become plus, M1 U1. Okay. So we can write this way, M2 V2 and M2 V2 plus, this will come on left hand side, M1 V1, and this M1 U1 plus, this will go to right hand side and this will become plus M2 U2. So we can say that the magnitude of total final momentum, the magnitude of total final momentum is equals to the magnitude of total initial momentum. This is total final momentum and this is total initial momentum. Final momentum and initial momentum. This V gives us final and this U gives us initial. Okay, so we can say that the magnitude of total final momentum is equals to magnitude of total initial momentum. So we can say that if no external force is acting on two objects, then their total initial momentum is equal to their total final momentum. This statement is true for any object. If two objects collide with each other, that means whatever momentum comes over there initial, that much momentum will be final. Okay, when no external force acts on two intersecting object, their total momentum remains constant and it does not change. Very important statement. When no external force acts on two intersecting object, their total momentum remains constant, it does not change. Okay. So this is corollary of Newton's third law of motion. The momentum is unchanged after the collision. The momentum gets redistributed between the colliding object. Whatever momentum getting changed, that is getting distributed in it. Okay. The momentum of one of the object decreases while that of the other object will increase. Thus, we can also state this corollary as follows, this way, that when two objects collide, the total momentum before collision is equal to the total momentum after collision. So whatever the two momentum over there, they get distributed with each other. Suppose we are having total amount of momentum is 4, then with one momentum 1 and with another 3, otherwise with one momentum 2, other with 2. Okay, so this way, when two objects gets collide, the total momentum before collision is equal to the total momentum after collision. To understand this topic, we are having a basic basic example for the same. Suppose we have gun and a bullet. So to understand this principle, consider one example. A bullet fired from a gun, when a bullet of mass M1, the bullet has a mass M1, is fired from a gun of mass M2. So bullet has mass M1 and the gun has mass M2. So after firing, its velocity becomes V1 and its momentum will be M1 V1. Before firing the bullet, both the gun and the bullet are at rest and hence the total initial momentum becomes 0. According to the above law, the total and final also has to be 0. If the initial momentum is zero. As per law, if initial is zero, then final will also be zero. According to the above law, the total final momentum has to be zero. Thus, the forward moving bullet causes the gun to move backward. You must have seen in pictures and all when the gun is getting firing. So whatever bullet comes forward, the gun is having a motion of backward. So this backward motion of the gun is called its recoil. The velocity of recoil is V2. So we can substitute these values. We are having a formula for the same is M1 V1 plus M2 V2. And its initial momentum is 0. So that is why if it is 0, then we are getting this formula. And if you are taking this V2 on this side, as it is left hand side, the remaining things will go to right hand side, and this will become this way. V2 is equals to minus of M1 upon M2 into V1. Let me clear this very clearly. Like, if this is 0, why this is 0? Because its initial momentum is 0. Now M2 V2 take as it is on left hand side and shift M1 V1 on right hand side. M1 V1, this will be minus. Okay, so at the left hand side V2 will be there, and right hand side M1, this M2 will shift on right hand side. M1 upon M2 with minus sign into this V1. Okay, so this formula we are getting. So I stop my lecture over here. Your homework is, you have to write as homework is Newton's first law, second law and third law of motion, and this will be fourth law of conservation of momentum. Okay, so Newton's first law, second law and third law of motion, and this you have to write. Okay.